hear it, you know, all the different nuances of the language as a beginner. And then from that point on, I basically have been learning Arabic my whole life ever since, you know, different dialects, and I'll get into some of the dialects of Arabic in a little bit. But, you know, there's only so much you can kind of take in as a non-native speaker of a language at any given time. And so we have this progression that we do in our career field where we add dialects to what we do because Arabic is such a diverse language. It's so very different. You can't really compare English to, you can kind of, and I'll go over some examples of that, but it's very different from what we're used to. You know, I'll do classes about every year, every other year, where I'll just spend 4 to 8 weeks doing 8 hours a day of nothing but Arabic, just focusing on different skill sets, whether it's listening to different types of people speak, reading, you know, higher level of language. You have different, basically, in our career fields, what we do, we sort of rate levels of language, and you have what we call the level one material, and that's real basic information like this is purple, this is a room, things like that. Very basic information. And then as you progress in the language, you get to level two, level three, level four, and the highest level and when you're acquiring a language is level five. And that means you're extremely proficient in all nuances of the culture, things like poetry, understanding music when you hear it, all those different things that goes into colloquial language. That's like the ultimate goal, and that's very hard to achieve, obviously, unless you're a native speaker of the language. So what I do, I'm kind of a specialist, so there are lots of different dialects. Almost every country has their own specific dialect in the Arab world. I'm kind of a North African specialist, so Sudan, Chad, Libya are the ones that I focused on over the years, and My real specialty is Sudanese Arabic and South Sudanese. It's a different form of Arabic called Juba Arabic. But I can handle in most of the other dialects. Egyptian dialect, it's fairly simple. And then you have the Levantine dialect, which is Syria, Jordan, and a little bit of Iraq right here. Saudi dialect is its own thing. Yemeni dialect is its own thing. This is called Gulf dialect, and it kind of stretches from Oman. This is Bahrain right here, Kuwait. So the Gulf dialect is a little bit different. Iraqi's its own animal. And then this is where it gets really weird. Starting on the other side of Libya, Tunisia, Algeria. Tunisia and Libya share some common characteristics, but Algeria and Morocco, it's very heavily French influenced, that dialect. And it's very different. And it's almost mutually unintelligible between like an Egyptian speaker and a Moroccan speaker who can both be speaking Arabic to each other and not understand a single word of what the other is saying. It's really crazy. So the one common thing that binds them all is what's called modern standard Arabic, and that's the Arabic that you'll see on the news. And it's what's taught in school, and it's their link to classical Arabic, which is from the Quran. And I know you guys have been studying some aspects of the Quran and the language there. So modern standard Arabic, that's what, you know, I initially studied when I acquired Arabic. And then from there, you take on aspects of the dialects wherever you want to kind of specialize. But that's the interesting aspect of it. You know, even though there are so many dialects in the world, or in the Arab world, Egyptian dialect is kind of like the main one because it's more or less the Hollywood of the Middle East. So a lot of the movies, television, they're all produced in Cairo. And so a lot of the Arab world understands Egyptian dialect fairly well. And the differences in dialect are pretty strange. So sometimes it's pronunciation, and I don't know if we have a marker I could write on the board or somewhere I could write. And I'll just give you an example. So this is a letter, it's called Kaf. It makes a K sound. So in Arabic, there are like two K-ish, Q-ish sounds. There's calf and cough. So calf makes the K sound, the normal K sound for us. Cough kind of makes what we call a Q sound. So in Sudan, cough becomes gough. They change that Q to a G, Libya does the same thing. Saudi Arabia does the same thing. Iraq does the same thing. Egypt, they turn the cough into a ha. So they don't even pronounce it. It's called a hamzation. So a word like gal, which is means to say or to speak, they'll say ah. So they completely swallow the cough sound. And that's one of the differences there. Egypt does that, and the Levantine dialect does that. Another one is the J sound. It's called a jeem. So almost all of the Arab world pronounces jeem, j, that it gets the J sound out of it. Egypt is the one outlier. They say g, so they change the G, J to a g sound. And that's why in letters like a little joke, we call them Egyptians because of the way they pronounce their language. But so that causes confusion because now if you're not familiar with Egyptian dialect and you hear the k sound or the G sound becoming a g, you might be thinking it's a cough becoming a g. So it causes all kinds of confusion, right, in between the different dialects. And here's the other tricky part, because Arabic is what we call it's a root system language. So all words in Arabic have a three-letter root, and I'll use Salama. So Salama is, so you have three letters there. And Arabic, for the most part, doesn't have vowels. They have these little diacritical marks. And if you don't see the diacritical marks, you have to kind of guess what the voweling is. It makes it very difficult as an English speaker, right? So all words have three-letter roots for the most part, like 99%. There are some outliers. There are some weird words that don't do that. But so that's the root of the word Islam right there. It comes from Salama, which is to submit, to receive. So you can get Islam from that, which is the language Islam, right? Or the religion Islam. You can get Salam, which means peace. You can get Istislam, which means to receive. So basically, you have all of these forms of the word from this three-letter root. You can take this word and expand it out, and this is where it becomes like there's a grammar aspect to this. I don't want to get too deep into it. But I just want to kind of give you guys an example of what it's like to take on or to learn a language like this. It's very different grammatically from English, obviously. The root, so you know, in English, you typically have subject, verb, direct object, right? Like the car went to the house, whatever. In Arabic, the verb can appear anywhere in that sentence. So it doesn't really matter where it's at. So you can have went, car, to the house, went to the house, car went to the house, car went. So it's kind of strange like that, right? It's very difficult, like I said, from us with our very sort of linear thinking when it comes to grammar. It's a big change. I was going to go over one more verb we have here. Just kind of illustrate a little again about the three-letter group here. So ketaba is the verb for to write. Ketaba. Tab is the word for book. So that kind of makes sense, right? You have that three-letter word, kataba and kitab. You add that aleph in there, which is another letter. That's a variation of that root word. Mekteb, so when you add a meme to the front, it becomes a noun, a place, or doing, right? So a mekteb, put a meme in the front, now that's either an office or a desk. Kitab. Thank you. those roots. So as long as you understand a root and know what it basically comes from, and you understand the grammar system, then you can kind of figure out the meaning of a word, potentially. Do you guys have any questions about anything? I know I'm just kind of like throwing crazy stuff at you.
What are some of the basic like sentences that you learned early on? Because I would love for them to just hear like some of it authentically spoken.
Yeah, so, you know, the greetings, of course, are always the first things you kind of learn when you're dealing with a foreign language. Salamu alaikum is a very common greeting. That's a greeting that's usually delivered throughout the Arabic world, but generally among Muslims. And then the response to salam alaikum is wa alaikum as-salam. Now, there are lots of Christian groups within the Arab world. A lot of people think of the Middle East as all Muslims, right? But Egypt has a huge Coptic Christian community. Lebanon has the Druze and the Maronites. The Iraqis have the Sobaini, the Assyrians, the Ashuri, as they call them in Arabic. So there are huge Christian populations still within the Arab world, and they tend to greet each other differently. Instead of saying Salaam Alaikum when they greet each other, they'll say Sabah Khair, which means good morning. Sabah Noor, good evening. Kefa Hal, which is how are you? And then the response to Kefa Hal, depending on if you're Muslim, they'll say Alhamdulillah, which means praise be to God. But if you're a Christian, they'll tend to say something like Tamam, which is I'm good, or you know, Mawatal, which is not bad.
Was that other one again?
Which one?
The I'm good.
Tamam.
Tamam.
Tamam. Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. More or less, Tamam. That's how you would say it. That means good. That's very common in the Arab world. Kul shay tamam. Everything's good. That's another variation of tamam. Yeah, it's something they say. But
what are the differences between the street talk and like the professional?
So it's very different. It's kind of like with us, right?